guys know what acetone is? Okay, also, fingernail polish remover, water. Acetone's chemical formula looks like this. All right? So, with that chemical formula, and we talked about what's happening at the surface with some of these water molecules, right? Or some of the acetone molecules. What's going on here? They're evaporating. And get into it more, though. Tell us more of the story.
So, you can tell there's a experimental equilibrium.
Nah, not that story. There's this water molecule, right? Been living with this family all his life,
oh,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
Their grandparents are all there. Oh, look, yeah, you're so cute. He wants to what?
Oh,
he wants to be on his own. How is he going to get on his own?
He's got to leave.
It takes some energy to do the job, though, right? Overcoming somewhat. So here's water as a liquid, and if I'm going to take it to a gas, is that going to require energy or release energy?
It's going to require
energy because you're over. What are you doing? Not breaking bonds. Overcoming intermolecular forces, right? So the delta H here is a positive or a negative values?
Positive.
Right? So how about this one? Okay, whoops, H2O as a liquid, going to H2O as a solid, requires or releases energy? Releases energy?
Yeah.
You sure about that?
Yeah.
So that one for me is a little bit harder to see. This, I can see the intermolecular forces that need to be overcome because we're separating the molecules.
Actually, it's... it comes from more structure, so it releases energy, right?
Yeah, right, it is releasing energy. And another way we can think of it is, if this is going to a... so if this is a H2O gas, it's going to a liquid, that is... so liquid going to a gas, we just said, requires energy. Right? True? Liquid going to a gas? That's a change, sorry. Liquid going to a gas requires energy. Therefore, gas going to a liquid releases or requires? Releases energy. So this one is releases as well. The back way here is delta H requires energy. Okay, so this one's the easy one to see. Oh, not that one. This one's the easy one to see, right? Going from a liquid to a gas. It's easy to tell that it requires energy. So all the others you can derive from understanding that. Okay? So where is this water molecule going to get its energy to jump away from its family?
Oxygen.
That's right. The molecules up there on the surface are coming and bombarding it. Okay? It's also dependent on how much other stuff there is. Because yes, they're giving energy, but it does require a little bit of energy for this thing to work its way through whatever molecules are in the way. Okay? So another way to think about this is if I have a container of water in the cold air in this room, it'll evaporate at some rate. But if I put it outside, now temperature is another factor as well. But when I go into a humid environment, that means there's more water molecules in the air. And what are those water molecules in the air doing? They're floating, but they're also landing every once in a while, condensing. And they're making it harder for these guys to come out because when they leave, they have to bump up or run into them, and they might get held down a little bit, right? Yeah. So, you got this is what we call an equilibrium, correct? Water molecules coming in, water molecules leaving and coming back. If I have it inside a container, we'll reach that equilibrium. There will be a certain number of water molecules that end up in the gaseous phase. This will go down a little bit, right? A little bit of evaporation, but it'll come to an equilibrium. Evaporation will stop. This air will be saturated, right? I mean, you wouldn't feel anything special there, right? It's like the way we would feel this air right now. But the water molecules coming on and leaving would be in equilibrium.
Question. Mm-hmm. Would it be 100% humidity, or where would it stop? Because 100% humidity is when the air can't be saturated by any more water. So would it just naturally go to that point?
Yeah, I guess. Is there anything else in there? Weather's a tricky thing. Is there any other reason why right there?
The water's too hot.
I mean, 100% you're going to need difference in different temperatures, right? So that is another factor. So if you're in a cooler room and you have water all around you, if the room is cold, then the water will evaporate less than if the room is really hot. So it's depending on temperature. But in this one here, we decided last class that there would be how many more or fewer molecules of acetone in the air?
More.
Because what? Yeah, this intermolecular force here is very weak. What kind of intermolecular force can this do here? It can do a dipole, right? There's a dipole right there. But mostly, yeah, van der Waals, no hydrogen bonding. Okay, I mean, not mostly, I should say, but it's got plenty of van der Waals. Okay, so when you have a gas, water in the gaseous phase or acetone in the gaseous phase, in a space, what results is a pressure. Correct? Gas inside a balloon, gas inside the room, there's a pressure associated with that. And so we call that a vapor pressure inside a container like this when we have a liquid that's evaporating to some extent. Which one of these do you think would have a higher vapor pressure?
Right.
Yeah, the one on the right, because there's more molecules in the gaseous phase in the same volume.
How do you measure those? Is that just a measure of vapor pressure? By the amount of vapor solid?
Yeah, right. I mean, so if you know how many molecules are there in a given area, you can use Bergner, and you can identify what the pressure would be between the temperature and the temperature, R, and the volume. Okay. So, vapor pressure, and we'll talk more about vapor pressure in the future. So, we want to see what we can do in this place here. Okay. Anybody have kids in here? Anybody have kids? I had three kids by the time I was at your point in my career. I don't have any kids. How am I getting doing? All right, so one of the things you have to deal with when you have kids is they get fevers, especially when they're little. It's scary, right? And when you take care of a child with a fever, the doctors used to say, you call the line, you got a fever of 103. What should I do? Put a little bit of wet washcloth on their back and cool them down. They wake up in the middle of the night and looks like they're going to die or something. So you put a little bit of water on their tiny back and try to cool them down and stuff like that. But one thing that can really cool them down fast, just like in 2 minutes sort of thing, is rubbing alcohol. You don't want to get it in their eyes or anything, but you put it on your hand, put it on their back, and that rubbing alcohol, why does it cool people down a lot faster than water? It evaporates faster. That's why we sweat, right? Our sweat cools down our bodies as it evaporates. True? Evaporation requires energy, right? And our bodies was providing that energy to this reaction to proceed. So, now, the danger is, and this is why the doctor won't tell you to do it anymore, is because it can get them cold really fast too. But if you just put a little bit on their back and their tummy and wait just like 2 or 3 minutes, they'll be cooled down enough, and you dry them off good and put them in their little blankie, and they'll really fast. Yeah.
So does the heat difference from evaporation not having to do with the specific heat of the substance? Because
that's a very good question, and we'll get into that. So it's not related to what we call specific heat, because you're not just warming the water, you're evaporating the water, or warming the alcohol, evaporating the alcohol. So specific heat for alcohol is probably actually less, doesn't require as much energy to warm up the liquid, but the amount of evaporation that can occur is much higher than alcohol because why?
Because of the lower specificity.
Well, because that's fewer intermolecular forces, right? Not ethanol or isopropanol can hydrogen bond, but it still has a lot of bulky areas that doesn't allow it to get as close to each other, so hydrogen bonds are not as strong. So, which one of these would be correct? D, B, A, or C? Those are the answers. Those choices. You guys find them correct. Talk to your neighbor a little bit. I'm not going to drink water. Talk to your neighbor.
Water.
What's the temperature of that water? 200 degrees Fahrenheit or 100 degrees Celsius used to be the right answer. But as of today, it is no longer the right answer.
300.
No. Now, what you have to say when somebody asks you, what's the temperature of this water, or what's the boiling point of water? You have to say, at what pressure? At what pressure? Right? Because if you're at the top of the mountains, is the water easier for water to boil up there, or harder?
Harder.
Easier. Why is it easier? There's less stuff in the way, so the surface ones can jump off easier, right? Less pressure. Pressure is how much gaseous stuff is in the way. In space, the boiling point of water?
Wait, so what's the difference? On the International Space Station?
In the International Space Station, and gravity is not the component, right?
So it would just be the same as, like, whatever, right?
Yeah, inside there, because they're providing an atmosphere related to people's body.
But in zero pressure.
Zero pressure should be.
Yeah,
I don't know, it would always be a gas, right? I don't know why it would be different. I don't know. That's mind-boggling, because if you take that, and then all of a sudden it goes to a gas, where do those molecules go? Do they just forever? Are they going to head to the other side of the universe?
Wait, you say if there's no pressure, it won't be in an open state?
I don't think it will.
Wait, so well, what about the molecular loss?
They're there. They're there. But
they're not enough to get it together?
I don't think they would. But I don't know. Maybe they're stronger than that. Now that was inside the gas station. The station where the pressure was put for some reason. Body, right? So that's basically the pressure that put in here.
So hydrogen water?
It might be. I don't know. That's a good question. We can, you know, ask my phone real quick. But this is going to have to be confused. What do you mean in space? What's the boiling point of water in space? So it says at zero pressure, the temperature degrees it boiled at 20 degrees Celsius.
Oh my goodness. That's like.
Space is lower than 20 degrees Celsius. So, 20 degrees Celsius, that's about room temperature, right? Yeah. 20 to 25 degrees Celsius is room temperature. So, if you have room temperature conditions, which is highly unlikely, it's definitely probably going to be, what, colder or warmer in space?
Colder.
Way colder, right? What's that?
Depends on where you are in space.
Yes, if you're in any way from the sun, I don't know if that's space still, but maybe. Or if you're in line with the sun, I guess it's really hot all of a sudden. I don't know. Anyways, what's the boiling point of water?
It depends
on the pressure. That's right. So we got this water boiling. In fact, so that there's no confusion about that, we have a new phrase. The normal boiling point. Which means under normal pressure conditions of a laboratory or a room like this. Alright? So what's the normal boiling point of water? 100 degrees Celsius, 212 Fahrenheit. Okay? So that's something we have to be familiar with. And now I'm going to ask you this. Here is a block of ice. What's the temperature of that ice? Good. At room pressure, at one atmosphere.
Can you have negative pressure, like if something's being pulled into a vacuum?
I don't think so, right? Negative, there's zero pressure, which means there's no other molecules in a container.
Right.
Which is really, really hard to get to. I don't think we can get there.
But what if, like, you were to have a vacuum, and then you were to keep sucking molecules up, there's water, and then there's no oxygen, but then there's a vacuum that's pulling the water molecules?
Well, yeah, have you ever seen that before? You have a container full of water, you pull a vacuum line, and it starts to boil. So eventually you've sucked out all the air, so all the water molecules say, okay, we can go easy now, so they just start going off. So they'll be there in the atmosphere until you pull all of that. And then depending on the strength of your vacuum. We have a really strong vacuum for our mass spectrometer, but we still don't get down to more than like, well, 10 to the minus 24. They have reactions where they just throw stuff at each other under space conditions. This is a really cool part of research. They try to perform chemical reactions that would occur from just stuff floating around in space, right? And they try to figure out how in the world DNA or amino acids or nucleotides could result just simply by combining these different things that might collide in space. So they try to get as low pressure as possible. I mean, they have this huge, huge chamber to pull a really strong vacuum inside, a really strong vacuum inside, a really strong vacuum. So they have this really small container, and then they put little bits of different molecules in there. With other molecules, they shine it, irradiate it with UV, because there's tons of UV and X-rays in space, right? And they've been able to make a lot of molecules. So simply like throwing stuff in there and looking at the mass spectra. So they have a good idea of how these types of things eventually could have evolved in evolutionary explanation for how stuff exists in this view. But anyways, what's the temperature of this block of ice? Okay, we already said normal pressure. What's the temperature of this under normal pressure conditions? Okay, and did you hear the little end part? It could be as low as 0 Kelvin, right? It could be really, really cold. It's a solid. We don't know what its temperature is, right? If I draw a little puddle of water around it, now you know that its temperature is 0 degrees, right? Or pretty close to. Pretty close to zero.
Does it get more orderly the colder it gets?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, no. After it gets ordered, freezing it more, those molecules can't adjust very well. If you want to get a very well-ordered system, then you go to 0 degrees Celsius, go up to 3 degrees, back to zero, up to three, back to zero, fluctuate, and let the molecules kind of go melt and recrystallize, and then they adjust into a nice system. So be very careful. Does that make sense? And that's a big deal, because if you have a crystal of something, then magic can occur. Crystals are magical, right? And if you have crystals, then you can do magic. If you just have like a chunk of frozen stuff, that's not a crystal, right? A crystal is a perfectly shaped size of crystal. Ice can't form crystals.
Is crystal ice triangle?
It's a hexagonal thing. That's why snowflakes are all hexagonal in some shape, right? Okay, so we were talking about that thing. Oh yeah, let's talk about this really quick. We're playing Pictionary. You tell me what this is. Something you bring to the beach.
Cooler.
That's right. And inside the cooler we have ice and a six pack. Right. Some sort of drinks. Right. What's the temperature of the stuff in that cooler? Do your drinks ever freeze?
No.
No, they'll never freeze. Right. But they'll get cold. What's the temperature of this pile of ice and drinks?
10 degrees
Celsius. Okay, Celsius, it's about 0 to 4 degrees Celsius. 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. Right? Because it's ice, so it's cold. Now, after the day is almost done, and all your ice is almost all melted, you have three lone pieces floating around, a bunch of water now. What's the temperature of the drinks?
37.
It's still about the same, isn't it? Because all the energy that's gone to the system hasn't been heating the water, it's been doing what? Melting the ice. Because it takes energy to melt the ice. So all the energy that goes in is melting the ice, overcoming those intermolecular bonds, and you can still get your 4 degrees. If you want to ship something, or if you want to go to the beach, and instead of bringing soda pops, you're going to bring those ice pops, you know, those little things that you flip off the top and suck on, right? Could you fill this thing up with ice pops and bring it to the beach?
Sure.
No. The ice pops would all be melting, right? Just like the sodas would stay frozen. What would you have to put in there to keep it frozen?
Dry ice.
Dry ice. What's dry ice?
Solid ice.
solid carbon dioxide. Solid carbon dioxide, right? If you store something in solid carbon dioxide, it will stay at what kind of temperature?
Pretty cool.
Yeah, like minus 20, minus 30 degrees Celsius. So it'll keep things frozen. Okay? So if you need to order something that needs to stay frozen, you ship it in dry ice. If you need to order something that'll stay cold, you ship it in ice. Right? Our refrigerator, right, that's about 4 degrees Celsius, equivalent to putting ice in it. Our freezer is minus 20. That's equivalent to a frozen situation. What do you give chips on in dry ice?
Is that what they use to make your refrigerator cold?
No. That's what they used to use. Now, how did refrigeration or air conditioning get started? Do you know this story? That's the first method. They put huge blocks of ice and they put fans over it, right? But why did they decide to put those in a room?
Why?
Why did they decide to put it into a room? Anybody know?
There was
no round table at all. That's a good question. There might have been early on in the process. Anybody else know?
Just make it last longer?
It was for, well, no, why did they want a room cold? That's what I want to know.
Oh, because there are other lines.
No. Why did they want a room inside cooled down really cold? They wanted to rule the world, right? And the way they were going to rule the world was to sell more newspapers, right? The person who could sell the most newspapers could rule the world. Did you know that? That's why newspapers were always such a big deal. You always told the truth with enough lies to make yourself look good, and you ruled the world. But when something happened, and everybody wanted to buy a paper, you go print it up in Chicago, and if it was humid, it would take like 3 hours to dry, maybe even a half a day to dry, and then you couldn't get the paper, right? So they said, if we cool this room down really fast, it would remove all the humidity, and it dries papers, we can sell them very fast, we can rule the world, right? So that's where it started. And I think I told you this before as well, but once they started doing that, they realized that people who worked in those rooms were extremely more productive, right? Because it was cooler, you know, and we're all used to it now. But that's one of the inventions. I mean, there's not an infinite number of inventions that has increased productivity over the span of this world, right? You guys know that number of inventions have increased productivity? Internet is one.
Human productivity?
Yes, in terms of we can produce more, we can do more with
press, cotton,
electricity.
Well, electricity. Electricity.
Spam.
Energy. So air conditioning is one of them. All right. The internal combustion engine. Electricity, I think you already mentioned that. Cell phones?
No.
Can you believe that? Smartphones have not increased productivity. In fact, our productivity has decreased since they've come out. And people are still trying to figure out why that's the case. But yeah, from about 1500 to about 1800, and you can go back even further, essentially the beginning of time, about 1800, people were doing basically the same thing, the same way, right? You had your cart, you had your apples, you had your horse pulling your cart, you walked around and did whatever, you had the bathroom in a hole, right? All those years. Then, something amazing happens around 1800, and then all these huge amounts of inventions and stuff that begins to change things drastically. But, since then, we've only had really small amount of crazy inventions that have changed the world drastically. So, we get stuck, you know, as a world thinking, oh yeah, progress is really making things a lot better and stuff like that. Kind of. But there really is large changes in the world that could occur, but you know, you can't think outside the box all the time. So we're always just kind of thinking like, yeah, I'll make a faster iPhone, or I'll make a faster car, or a cooler car. You know, it's always something better.